Okay, so this is Nathan. He is a member of BBKP and shares the studio with myself, Nick, and Craig. And
I know maths.
And he knows maths. He's a brain. He's a programmer. He's actually opened up his own channel recently, which is dedicated to exploring CNC laser cutting programming kind of projects. So he's already made a video illustrating how to cut out a mount for a tablet, which you can use as a tripod filming station. This coincides at a good time.
Because Samus doesn't know how to set this machine up.
Yeah, as always, there's always a moment where I get stuck. And normally when I get stuck, I ask Nathan questions.
I'm finally getting a bit of acknowledgement.
So in the earlier stages of the video, I started to change the belt. And I had anticipated that I would have to change the steps on the software. But as I was kind of moving the machine up and down and checking what the actual measurements were with the new belt, I realized it kind of seemed the same. And I didn't quite understand why. And instead of relaying this information to you, I'm just going to let Nathan explain what has happened.
Yeah, so it basically seemed exactly bang on, which just doesn't happen unless something's actually gone right that you didn't intend to go right.
The rare occasion.
Yeah, so essentially I asked Samus whether I could see the original pulleys that came with this machine from Inventables. So these are 2mm and like hem.
20.
So 20 teeth of 2mm step. And the pulleys that Savas bought, just by coincidence,
had 16.
Are 2.5 with 16 teeth, which and both 20 by. No? This is 22. Two.
That's 20, yes, times
20
two.
Times 2 equals 40. 16 times 2.5 equals 40.
So
basically, the diameter, the number of teeth on the pulley has compensated for the larger teeth.
Yeah.
Meaning the machine doesn't need any further configuration.
So it's actually even easier to replace the existing belt on this machine with something that's more durable. Because you don't have to faff about with that side of the software. Although it wouldn't actually be that difficult to do if you had to.
No. But that means that you don't need to know maths. Just forget the maths.
Welcome to the world of no maths.
But I guess we also came to a conclusion about the accuracy that you were concerned about as well, though, really,
yeah.
Which is, I mean, for number one, the depth gauge, we haven't found this out yet, but potentially the depth gauge tolerance may explain the anomalies that you were seeing anyway.
Yeah.
But I think essentially the best way to measure the accuracy of a machine like this, at least when you're not working in nanotechnology or whatever, is actually to measure the accuracy over a long distance rather than a shorter one. And if necessary, you know, if you want to know the accuracy per millimeter, what you want to do is move the machine by maybe 10 centimeters forwards and back. Number one, see if it comes back to exactly the same place. And if you want to know accuracy per millimeter, you just divide the distance it moved when you told it to move 10 centimeters by 100. Because if the accuracy, for instance, this error that Savas was seeing over a short distance, that error didn't mean that there was that kind of that proportion of error over a long distance.
Yeah.
And actually, when you're making parts for use in like the human scale world, it's actually the long distances that matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if potentially there's an error of 0.04 of a millimeter,
no.
As long as that error isn't amplified, so it's like
yeah.
The same. Yeah. I'm not communicating this very well.
Well, the other problem as I had as well was I basically like juiced up the
Well, that's because I told you to. I told Samas to juice the motors up, and it seems to...
And I juiced them on another level. Oh, that wasn't actually, sorry, that wasn't the problem. The problem was increased the feed rate on the software, and I assumed just because I had juiced up the motors, it was,
that it works,
was
that it
doing works. Okay, but actually what was happening was it was missing steps, which is annoying because I like this. I'd like to be able to have this machine running at a kind of faster operating time, which kind of reduces the waiting around thinking, oh, I could have done that quicker myself.
I think this actually raises something else we've been talking about this machine, though, which is, like, do you actually see it as a replacement in terms of both time and effort for a human? Or, like, I mean, because Savas is pretty skilled with manually cutting things out anyway, Savas is Savas is thinking, like, he doesn't really, I guess you don't really mind that you cut things out sometimes, and sometimes you see that as easier.
Yeah, definitely.
Whereas these machines, they can hit a very good level of accuracy. I mean, I'm not talking about this machine in particular. I mean, just in general, CNC machines, you know that the accuracy is guaranteed.
Yeah.
And if you just, like, kind of sitting back and letting it do its thing, and you don't care how long it's going to take, whereas if you see it as genuinely replacing... replacing a person's skill, I think there is a gap there.
Yeah.
I mean, for instance, I was talking to somebody the other week who had been invited to cut out parts for a steam engine, or several different parts for a steam engine, because the plasma cutter, while it was incredibly accurate, it would take longer than a person if that person was skilled. Mm. So it is a skill replacement facility, and personally I'm quite lazy and I'm not very good manually, I mean compared to someone who really knows what they're doing manually, so I think these machines are brilliant. That's because I just like sitting on my arse and watching YouTube videos while they cut.
But it's an interesting dilemma, and I think you know, like having a foundation of knowledge about making something helps you kind of engage with the machine and kind of know when it is doing something correctly and what your kind of alternative options are when it does bugger up as well. But the thing is, I mean, like we've spoken together about ideas where this type of technology could be used with very different type of material to make very strange objects. And I mean, I think the more we kind of understand how this works, the more likely we might actually, you know, have a CNC machine that glues pieces of popcorn together to make something.
Exactly. The potential is in actually pushing it towards doing stuff that a human couldn't or kind of wouldn't bother to do to the same degree of accuracy. It's like you couldn't make a popcorn sculpture that down to an accuracy of tenths of a millimeter even. You know, so
to the nearest kernel.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
I guess that pretty much covers it.
That sums it up. Right, so what's your... Come more this way.
Yeah.
So what's your...
I'm kind of learning to stay in shot at the moment.
What's your channel called?
So my channel is called Opentronics.
And where can you find that?
On the internet. On the internet. You need to go to an internet.
To an internet cafe? Is that a good place to start?
No, I mean, there are humans there, so just forget that bit.
Yeah. But I'll put a link in the card in the description to Nathan's channel. So when you click on those sections, they will open up and...
Cool, and hopefully there's going to be some decent content on there by the time anyone bothers to look at it. I'm, at the moment I'm working on software to actually go straight from a SketchUp model to laser cutter. Essentially, I've got a couple of videos on my channel already, but I realised already that probably most of the stuff that I said in those was nonsense. So, you know, that's something to come back for. it may make more sense as I go along.
He's going to clear up the nonsense.
I'm going to clear it all up.
As he has done today.
Yeah.
Brilliant.